This free program is paid for by the listener members of KPFK. If you're not already a member, consider joining with us and keep free speech alive.
You're going to love this. Just love it.
I know why. It's Pacifica. I get to say whatever I want. No corporate control. The public airwaves. Yes, I am. Stuck in the middle with you right here on KPFK Pacifica Radio in Los Angeles. 90.7 FM in L.A., 98.7 FM in Santa Barbara, 93.7 FM in San Diego, 99.5 FM in Ridgecrest and China Lake, and of course, coast to coast and around the globe on kpfk.org, on the Stitcher radio app, on the TuneIn radio app, on the Progressive Voices channel, and yes, 110,000 blazing watts of your public airwaves across the Southland here in Southern California. This is your BradCast. I'm Brad Friedman of BradBlog.com, your friendly citizen investigative blogger, journalist, troublemaker, muckraker, and all-around swell fellow, says me, here with you for another live hour. We've got another big show for you today, and we're going to be talking in a little bit. As you know, if you listen to the BradCast, if you follow my work at BradBlog.com, you know we sort of specialize in elections and not really the horse races as much as the track conditions for those elections. Well, we're going to have a couple of election-related stories coming up a little bit later in this hour, one of them concerning Stephen Colbert, actually Stephen Colbert's sister, Elizabeth Colbert Bush, is going to be running in a special election as a Democrat next month against the disgraced, or should we say the formerly disgraced, former governor of South Carolina, Mark Sanford. He won the, at least he was declared the winner yesterday of the GOP primary runoff. So he will be facing off on May 7th against Stephen Colbert's sister, for the congressional U.S. House special election in the 1st District in South Carolina. It's a very Republican district, at least it was in the 2012 election. And yet, Colbert Bush is said to be leading right now, leading Mark Sanford by 3 or 4 points. But that's not what I'm going to tell you about. I'm going to tell you the story that you won't otherwise hear. You may not even otherwise hear it at all. If you do hear it anywhere in the corporate media, it will be after it is too late. So I'll be talking to you about that in a little bit. Also have an update for those of you who may remember last year, the GOP voter registration fraud scandal, which we covered in great detail in the run-up to the presidential election, as the Republican firm hired to do registration work around the country in 7 or 8 key swing states was found to be submitting fraudulent registrations. And in fact, one of those folks who worked for that firm was arrested in Virginia just days before the presidential election when he was spotted tossing voter registration forms into a dumpster behind a strip mall. We've got an update in that story coming up later this hour as well. So you're going to want to hang on for that. And, of course, Desi Doyen will be joining us as usual for the Green News Report. So plenty straight ahead. But first, Shadows of Liberty is a new documentary film. It features faces and voices that I know you're familiar with here on KPFK, folks like Julian Assange, John Nichols, Dan Rather, Amy Goodman, Robert Perry, Robert McChesney, Dan Ellsberg, many more, including yours truly. I appear in the film as well, but don't let that dissuade you. It's an excellent film anyway. It reveals the extraordinary truth behind commercial news media in the U.S., censorship, cover-ups, and corporate control. Filmmaker Jean-Philippe Tremblay takes a journey through the darker corridors of the commercial U.S. media system where global conglomerates call the shots, which they do not do here at KPFK Pacifica. For decades, their overwhelming influence has distorted news journalism and compromised its values. The film has its U.S. premiere right here in Southern California on Thursday. It'll be on KCET, I'm happy to say. Thursday, April 5 at 8 p.m., both Eastern and Pacific, and it will also be on Link TV nationwide on Dish Channel 9410 and DirecTV Channel 375. That is on Friday it will be premiering, but it will also be streaming online beginning tomorrow, Thursday, April 4 at 9:30 p.m. At shadows.kcetlink.com. .org. I'll give that address out a few times because you are going to want to watch this entire film. Here to talk about this entire film is the filmmaker Jean-Philippe Tremblay. He's a native of Quebec. He joined Doc Factory, the organization, the independent documentary production house that made Shadows of Liberty, the media monopoly in American journalism. He began filming Shadows of Liberty in 2006. It was completed last year, and it debuts this Friday on KCET and Link TV, and it will be streaming online for free tomorrow at shadows.kcetlink.org. Here to talk with us about this film, which, by the way, I think is terrific, is Jean-Philippe Tremblay, the filmmaker. Jean-Philippe, welcome, sir, to KPFK's BradCast.
Thank you very much, Brad.
So great to have you here, and congratulations on the film. Really enjoyed it. Got to watch it over the weekend. Just some really interesting stuff. A lot of stories that I was actually familiar with a lot of it, but you found a lot of elements that even I didn't know about. And we're going to get to some of those in a bit here. I've got some extended clips I'd like to play from the film. But before we get there, today, I should point out, Greg Mitchell at The Nation notes that 3 years ago today, Julian Assange in Iceland prepared for the release of Collateral Murder, the video from Iraq that was allegedly released by Bradley Manning that really, I think, put WikiLeaks on the map. That was 3 years ago today, and 10 years ago, just a few days ago, the beginning of the Iraq War, in which our country was lied into war. How do you see those two issues speaking to each other, Jean-Philippe? In one case, where you had a country lied into war, and another case where Julian Assange, years later, releases what is actually going on in this war. Do you think that was, and I know that's in your film as well, but do you think the release of that information, the creation of WikiLeaks, is sort of a direct response to the media failures that we saw in the lead-up to the Iraq War?
Yes, thank you, Brad. I just want to start off by saying thank you again for having me, and it's just a real pleasure to be. I'm talking to you from Canada, from Montreal, but in essence, I'm speaking to the United States today, to California, and I just want to say what a pleasure it is to finally be in the United States after we have finished the film. We finished the film over a year ago and have attempted to come and screen it and show it in the United States, and now we finally have the chance, and that's why we're speaking today. So it's just a pleasure to be here, and thank you again for having me.
My pleasure. And I have some specific questions about that, but first let me hit this this point on Iraq and WikiLeaks.
Yes, well, like you mentioned, we do talk about these two subjects in the film. Mm-hmm. On the Iraq War, it's a lie. It was sold by the mainstream media, and that's what we talk about in the film. We talk to people from the New York Times and other mainstream media who explain how this fictitious story that started the Iraq War was publicized on the mainstream media. And now when we talk about WikiLeaks, we have an organization that is pushing the envelope on what we are able to publish. I mean, through WikiLeaks, we have found out information about corrupt governments, about corrupt organizations, how they operate. And what's interesting about WikiLeaks is they do, I mean, I call it new journalism. It's journalism like we've never seen it before. It's, first of all, it's using the Internet, which is the most powerful communications tool that we've ever seen throughout history. They can publish, which they have done, they publish 500,000 classified documents about what the American government has done in Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
Through those documents, we find out about a lot of the actions have been corrupt, have been unanswered. And like you mentioned as well, collateral murder, this video clip about American helicopters shooting down citizens in Iraq, you know, it did put WikiLeaks on the map. And it's important for us to really notice what's happening with WikiLeaks, what opportunities we have with the Internet and with independent media to approach a new journalism and to keep power accountable, because that's what journalism is all about. We're trying to ask the right questions. We're trying to find out what are doing in our name, in countries.
Let me play a clip, Jean-Philippe, from the film. This is from Shadows of Liberty. And it's a short clip where Julian Assange speaks of just that, and it's sort of it's up against, you hear Julian Assange speaking, and then it's up against the way the media, not just the media, but the government, are sort of working in cahoots to stop guys like Julian Assange. Let me play a quick clip here.
It is by making publishing cheap that permits many more people to become publishers, that permits many more different voices. That's where the Internet has really excelled. WikiLeaks has published a lot of information about war, about militaries, how they behave, intelligence organizations. And that information often comes as a surprise to the public. It's because the public has been lied to.
Should the United States do something to stop Mr. Assange?
We're looking at that right now.
Mr. Connell says he's a high-tech terrorist. Others say this is akin to the Pentagon Papers. Where do you come from?
I would argue that it's closer to being a high-tech terrorist than the Pentagon Papers.
It's amazing. You've got the Vice President of the United States going on Meet the Press, NBC's Meet the Press, and calling Julian Assange a high-tech terrorist. That absolutely blew my mind the day that happened, and it still echoes in my mind as, you know, as he's holed up in an embassy in Great Britain, or in where the heck is he? In London, isn't he?
Yeah, he's
right.
He's in London, inside the Ecuadorian embassy. He's been there for, I think, 8 months now.
And charged with no crimes, just having the temerity to tell the world what is going on is just amazing. All right, let me back up a little bit, Jean-Philippe. You start this film with a quote from Thomas Paine: "For when men yield up the privilege of thinking, the last shadow of liberty quits the horizon." And of course, that's the name of the film, Shadows of Liberty. What drew you to that quote initially, Jean-Philippe?
Well, really, we were just looking for a title for the film, and we started doing some research and came upon some iconic quotes and from the forefathers of the United States, and we thought it was fitting to call it Shadows of Liberty based on this quote, because that's what it's all about. I mean, that's what we ask out of journalism as well. It's to keep thinking, to keep asking critical questions to keep power accountable. So the quote seemed like a very fitting beginning to our film, and also a title to our film as well.
I want to go back to one of the there's some terrific stories you tell in this film. One of them concerns Roberta Baskin, reporter with CBS News back in the 90s, when I remember this well, when we were getting information about Nike and the sweatshops they were using, the sweatshop conditions for their factories in I think Vietnam, is it?
Yeah.
In East Asia, in any case. And CBS began to report on this story. Nike began to respond and say they were looking into it. And then Roberta Baskin went out to some of these factories and talked to some of the folks there about the conditions and was about to break a couple of rather important reports, as I understand it, when she was suddenly stopped by CBS. And I hadn't known about this, and to this day apparently CBS has not covered this. Let me play an extended clip from this film, because this is one of many extraordinary stories in Shadows of Liberty.
As Baskin was putting together the updated news report on Nike's labor practices, she received unexpected news from inside CBS.
I got a call from my executive producer who said the story is not going to air. It's been taken off schedule. There's some sort of deal being made between Nike and CBS News for the upcoming Winter Olympics. The air went out of my soul.
CBS News was paying an enormous amount of money for the rights. And so by definition, they would be seeking out commercial sponsors who would pour lots of money into it so that they could recoup the millions that they were paying for the rights of the Olympics.
The 18th Olympic Winter Games on CBS.
As CBS revealed their Olympic coverage, the deal between Nike and CBS was plain to see.
Correspondent after correspondent are wearing these Nike jackets on the air with a little CBS something or other. You really couldn't read it, and a big swoosh on the shoulder. That was the deal. Nike had convinced CBS News to turn its correspondents into billboards. It was heartbreaking.
The CBS News correspondents were furious. They had to wear the Nike parkas whenever they appeared on air. It's just not done.
Baskin wrote a memo requesting CBS management to take the Nike logo off correspondence.
CBS had crossed this incredible line. How do you trust serious stories when you're seeing the reporter wearing a bunch of logos? Immediately, the president of CBS News responded, saying this was a breach of professional etiquette. It meant that I should shut up. How dare I raise a question about the integrity of CBS News?
After questioning the deal with Nike, Baskin was removed from her position as the chief correspondent of CBS News.
It wasn't an ordinary transfer, a change. It was a demotion. And it was a demotion that it was to send a message.
Message received. That's from Shadows of Liberty, which premieres this Friday on KCET here in Southern California and Link TV across the country, I believe. Jean-Philippe, the filmmaker, is with us. Is that the first known instance of that happening? Because I think people will see that story and, you know, we see this all the time now, where you have the sponsorships, these corporate sponsorships tied up with the networks. And I don't even think people think twice about it and the effect that it may have on some of these newsrooms. Was that the first such instance that was so blatant like that back in the 90s? I think 96.
I don't know if it was the first instance, but it's certainly something that journalists are confronted more and more, and especially in the last 30 years, and like you say, especially now. And what we just heard right there, the clip from Shadows of Liberty, is basically how we tell our story of media monopoly in the United States. We went out and we found journalists, and not any journalists, someone like Roberta Baskin. She was chief correspondent at CBS News for a number of years. She's one of the most awarded female journalists in the United States. She has something like over 75 journalistic awards from the United States. So when she goes out and does a report, she knows exactly what she's doing, and she's been awarded for it.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, she goes out and does a report on Nike sweatshops in Vietnam. And as we heard, her story is taken off the air. It's taken off the schedule. The American public cannot know the research and the report that she's conducted. And I guess that was our goal, really, was to tell our stories through personal stories. So we have journalists throughout the film that have an idea or that are struck by corruption, either government corruption or corporate corruption. They try to report it, and they're stopped by the very powers that control the media.
Was she given a reason for, at the time, that her reports could not go out?
I mean, like we said here in the clip, she said that she was, her boss said that she was breaking professional etiquette, you know, and what she said is that meant that she should shut up. You know, so when you question editors, when you question heads of the media, then you suffer the consequences, and that's exactly what happened to Roberta Baskin.
And that shows, you know, sort of the media, the corporations beginning to merge with the media, even at CBS, which, you know, founder Bill Paley used to regard the CBS News division as the jewel in the Tiffany Network's crown. He knew it was not there to make money; it was there to, you know, for prestige. Essentially, but that all obviously began to change. You cover the sort of, you know, what happened when Reagan came into office and his background with General Electric, and how to him merging the corporation General Electric together with RCA was not really a concern. That was a success. That was something that he wanted to see, and it, you know, resulted in these mergers that began under him, the end of the Fairness Doctrine that continued through the Telecommunications Act under Bill Clinton. It continues today under Barack Obama and his woeful FCC head, Julian Genachowski, who I believe is leaving or has already left. But here's another clip from Shadows of Liberty. About the mergers that began in the 1980s under Ronald Reagan.
One merger symbolized the takeover of mass media by conglomerates seeking ever higher profits.
For General Electric, here is Ronald Reagan.
Good evening on this last Sunday before Christmas. The Christmas season is a time for the family. So
people should remember that Ronald Reagan was funded by large corporations, and so suddenly we saw a radical transformation of the media system in the United States.
General Electric and RCA, two of America's biggest and best-known companies, in a dramatic move last night, the two announced plans to merge this high-tech, multi-billion-dollar Wall Street wedding, complete with a major television network.
We'll now have the strongest network. We'll have a stronger defense piece. This is going to be one dynamite company.
The Reagan administration approved General Electric's purchase of major media holdings, despite ongoing violations of industry laws and practices.
Yes, he did, and that has only gotten worse since the 80s and since that merger. We've got fewer and fewer companies. Jean-Philippe, you mentioned earlier that the Shadows of Liberty was actually completed last year, early last year, January of 2012, and it is finally seeing its U.S. premiere. this week. What kind of did you attempt to get theatrical distribution in this country, or did you know that that was something that was probably not going to happen at all with a film like this?
Well, I guess we did finish the film a year ago. We had our world premiere in Toronto at the documentary film festival called Hot Docs. It's the biggest in America, the mm-hmm. biggest documentary film festival in America. And since then, we've gone, you can say, around the world with the film in film festivals. We've been in what I call the biggest documentary film festival in the world, which is the International Documentary Film Festival in Amsterdam. So we've been all around the world with the film. But we were not accepted in the large and medium-sized documentary film festivals or film festivals in the United States. What we do say in the film...
Let me ask. You're saying that the film festivals in the U.S., the independent film festivals, did not even welcome you, never mind commercial distribution, at the AMC theaters and everywhere else. But you're saying the film festivals in the U.S. didn't even want to accept this film?
We applied at most of the large and medium-sized film festivals in the United States. And we were not invited to the film festivals. We were invited to give credit to some of the smaller film festivals, Fallbrook in California, which I think starts in a couple weeks' time, and also Nashville. But other than that, we were not accepted in the United States. And that was a bit of a surprise at the beginning because, like I say, we have 38 cast members in the film. All of them are American, except for Julian Assange, who is Australian.
Mm-hmm.
But we have 37 of the most cutting-edge journalists in the United States. And you mentioned some of them at the top of your show, and they're just amazing contributors.
And in that last clip, we had John Nichols from Nation Magazine, Dan Rather, Dan Ellsberg is in this film. I got to tell you, Jean-Philippe, I'm somewhat stunned. I figured you might have trouble with commercial distribution of the film, but are these film festivals now in the U.S. just so tied up themselves with commercial interests and commercial sponsorship that they did not want to touch this film?
I mean, that's a good question to ask. I mean, a bit like the Roberta Baskin example that we just talked about. It's not like anyone comes up and says, you know, you cannot report your story because it's hurting our sponsors. You know, they won't say it that way. I have to say that I always got a lot of accolades about the film from all the film festivals in the United States, but the bottom line was that there wasn't enough room in their program for this film. So what we have done now is that we are going to premiere for the very first time in the United States, in Denver. That's tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
April the 4th. We are going to kick off the Media Reform Conference in Denver. That's held by Free Press. So that's a real honor for us. They've been a huge inspiration in the making of this film. And again, that was founded by, like you said, John Nichols and mm-hmm. Robert McChesney and Josh Silver. So we're very proud to do that. And it's also going to premiere on Link TV and KCET in the U.S. as of tomorrow evening.
Yeah, and streamed online at shadows.kcetlink.org. Let me see if I have some time just for one more clip or two here before I got to let you go, Jean-Philippe. I got to tell you, I'm just floored by the fact, you know, because I've seen the film. This is not a second-rate film. This is not a James O'Keefe production made in somebody's basement. This is a professional production, a smart story, I know it took you several years to make. I know you interviewed me for this documentary. I think it was already 3 years ago, and that it was turned down by so many film festivals in the U.S., I think is perhaps the most troubling point of our discussion, to be frank here today. Let me play a... one clip, listeners, readers of BradBlog.com will probably know some of this story. Folks here on the BradCast will know I've interviewed Sibel Edmonds. Speaking of the mainstream media who wants nothing to do with so many of these stories, let me play a one more clip here from Shadows of Liberty. You'll hear my voice at the beginning and then I think a few other times throughout this, but this is what I call, as you'll see, the mother of all scandals. And, well, maybe this is why you're not welcome in anybody's film festival. Let's find out. Here's a clip from Shadows of Liberty. This is the mother of all scandals. International finance, nuclear weapons, spying. And yet, New York Times, Washington Post, AP, ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox News, MSNBC, CNN, all of them, apparently couldn't give a damn about this story.
In the wake of 9/11, the media focused its attention on terrorism.
The threat of nuclear weapons falling into the hands of terrorists is real.
This is scary for people. The idea that a terrorist or a criminal enterprise could come up with a nuclear weapon or even a dirty bomb.
This was about 4 or 5 days after the September 11 terrorist attack when the FBI was asking people with language abilities to join the Bureau.
Sibel Edmonds would have been listening to evidence of criminal activity, corruption issues. The FBI was also looking at proliferation of nuclear materials, weapons transfers, weapons sales that were illegal.
One of the investigations by the FBI led toward Turkish groups involved in nuclear espionage.
What I was reviewing was not only in foreign language, a lot of them, in fact, were in English. It involved people from the State Department talking to the targets of these operations.
What Edmonds allegedly heard were conversations about the exchange of U.S. nuclear secrets between a Turkish group and Mark Grossman, a high-ranking State Department official.
Mark Grossman's conversation with the Turks was very definitely against U.S. interests. It also was a crime, because there were other conversations indicating that he had taken money from the Turks. So that is a clear issue of corruption in the U.S. government.
Edmonds discovered the alleged illegal sale of U.S. nuclear secrets.
She's talking about stolen secrets sold on the black market to, frankly, enemies of the U.S. Iran, Libya, North Korea, potentially even Al-Qaeda. This is happening in the highest level of the U.S. government.
When she reported her discovery to the heads of the FBI, their reaction was unexpected.
The assistant director of the FBI coming and boldly asking not to report this any further, that this was explosive, and just asking me to forget and move on.
When she continued to raise questions at the FBI, Edmonds was fired with no explanation.
So you're firing me without providing me with any reasons? And the response was, no, we are not firing you, we are terminating you. There's a big difference.
She took the FBI to court for wrongful termination, and the administration responded by silencing her under law.
This absurd state secrets privilege is absolute, and it requires no evidence.
absurd indeed. You'll have to go watch Shadows of Liberty to hear the rest of that story, or you can comb through the archives at bradblog.com, where we have been dealing with that story for many years. And we're talking about, as I said in that clip, nuclear secrets that go to the highest level of government. I do believe it is the mother of all scandals. And yet, you talk about Jean-Philippe in the film that this story was covered all over the country. I'm sorry, all over the world, front pages all over the world, yet not here in the U.S.
Yeah, that's right. We call that story in the film, it's entitled The Silence. And what we're talking about is silence stories, important stories that we should know as a population, as American citizens, yet it is not covered. It is ignored by the mainstream media. And while that's happening, other countries around the world are having those very same stories on their front pages, in their headlines. And that's the problem with the media in the United States, is that there's a lot of information that's happening every day around the world, but for some reason, the hardest place to get the information is in the United States. And it's a bit like what we were talking about just earlier about my film. Mm-hmm. I've made a film along with my team about the United States, about American journalism. And the one place that's hard to screen it, to get it shown, is in the United States itself. It's taken us a year to finally get to the United States. And once again, that's why I'm so happy to be talking to you today. And we're going to premiere the film tomorrow in Denver, and on Link TV and on KCET.
Shadows of Liberty, the media monopoly in American journalism. We've been speaking with Jean-Philippe Tremblay, the filmmaker of that remarkable documentary, which is apparently not welcome in the U.S. until now. It will premiere this Friday at 8 p.m., both Pacific and Eastern, on KCET here in Los Angeles, as well as nationwide on Link TV. That's Dish Channel 9410 and Direct TV Channel 375. It may be a different number in your hometown. Please give it a look. It begins also streaming for free online here in the U.S. and everywhere else at shadows.kcetlink.org. You can also watch clips from the film there. And I'll tell you what, Jean-Philippe, I'm going to do my best to help get the word out about this film, because I think it's a remarkable film, and even made more remarkable the trouble you've been having getting it out to an audience in the United States of America, of all places. Jean-Philippe, I hope to talk to you soon in the future. Thank you, sir, for all your good work on this, and good luck breaking into the U.S. here.
Well, thank you so much, Brad, for having me on, for being part of the film. The film we've dedicated to one of the greatest American journalists ever, Ben Bigdikian, whose book, The New Media Monopoly, we were really inspired by to make this film. And we've dedicated the film to him and to all journalists whom we consider are the heroes of our time. And I also want to say that we are also screening the film in theaters or in a theater in Los Angeles on April the 13th, coming up. And that's through New Filmmakers Los Angeles. So look that up, and hopefully we'll see you in Los Angeles on April the 13th as well, to see the film in a theater in Hollywood up in California.
I'd love to see you there. I'm going to do my best to get there. Check
Thank
it out
so
at
much.
shadows.kcetlink.org, and get more information at shadowsofliberty.org. Thanks, Philippe.
Thank you.
Can't allow this country to go down for the count because some guys on Wall Street can't make money producing garbage news.
The media is that kind of issue where if we want it to be better, we have to fight for it.
These are the critical battles we face right now in the United States and, frankly, in countries around the world.
This is really about having a conversation about what kind of decisions we want made in our name. that's really what will save us, is when we really know what's going on, not filtered through the lens or the microphone of a corporation.
Not filtered through the lens. You're listening to the BradCast on KPFK. I'm Brad Friedman. That was, of course, Amy Goodman from Shadows of Liberty. You're going to want to check out that film. We're going to take a quick break. Come back with some more stories not filtered through the corporate lens. You're listening to the BradCast. I'm Brad Friedman. Please stay with us.
This week on Smiley and West from PRI.
Renaissance Man, our dear brother Melvin Van Peebles.
How did you come up with this name, Laxative, for the band?
Because the music gets you going.
Melvin Van Peebles.
Next time on Smiley and West.
From PRI.
Smiley and West, Saturday morning at 11, right here on 90.7 FM, KPFK.
Next time on L.A. Theater Works, a macho ex-football player sees the sport's effort to reduce concussions as a sign of weakness.
Take away hitting from football, and you know what you get? Checkers.
Ernie Hudson and Deidre Henry star in Headstrong by Patrick Link. Next time on L.A. Theater Works. L.A. Theater Works, Thursday evenings at 7 on Southern California Pacifica Radio, KPFK.
Yeah, this is not the Colbert Report. This is your BradCast on KPFK. There's a reason I'm playing the Stephen Colbert theme song there. I'm going to get to that in a moment. I forgot to mention, you can tweet me at TheBradBlog. You can also, of course, find me at BradBlog.com. I am Brad Friedman. I just heard from Angela Carusoni. He's Go Angelo on the Twitters. I believe he is the man behind the Stop Rush movement. Thanks, Angelo. He tweeted me about the that documentary, Shadows of Liberty. Says, this is terrifying. You're damn right it is. Be terrified. All right, before I get to this Colbert story, Radio Unnameable is a documentary film about freeform radio pioneer WBAI's Bob Fass, playing a limited run at the Arena Cinema Theater here in Los Angeles, 1625 North Las Palmas in Hollywood, just around the corner from the Egyptian Theater. Radio Unnameable starts this Friday, April 5 through 11th. It's a special benefit for the Pacifica Radio Archives. That's right. It's the Pacifica Radio Archives, not corporate controlled, but rather radio by and for the people over our public airwaves. Radio Unnameable. Get more information on that at kpfk.org. Okay. Stephen Colbert's sister, as I said at the top of the show, his sister, Elizabeth Colbert Bush. It's really how you pronounce her name, is Colbert, is running as a Democrat in South Carolina. She has gotten the nomination from the Democratic Party for the U.S. House special election, which will be held on May 7th in the 1st Congressional District in the Great Palmetto State. She will now be running against Mark Sanford, the former governor, the disgraced former governor who is now happily engaged to the woman that he left his wife for while he was governor. He will be running against Colbert Bush next month. Sanford was named the winner of his GOP runoff yesterday, Tuesday, in South Carolina. It's going to be an interesting race for a number of reasons. Among them, the first district in South Carolina is a very Republican district, or at least it was in the 2012 election, or at least it was if you believe the voting machines that they use out there in South Carolina, which happen to be 100% unverifiable. I think Obama lost something like 55-45 in that district back in November of 2012, and yet Elizabeth Colbert Bush, at least as of now, according to two separate polls, is about 3 points in front of the Republican Mark Sanford. It will be very interesting what happens on May 7th. The problem is, whatever happens on May 7th, if she ends up losing by a landslide, if she ends up losing by 2 votes, there will not be a damn thing that she can do about it. Why? Well, South Carolina, you may remember South Carolina. That's the place that back in 2010 in the Democratic primary for U.S. Senate, a man by the name of Alvin Green, an unemployed, nearly illiterate man who no one had ever heard of, who had no campaign website, who had done no campaigning at all, ended up being named the winner of the Democratic primary for the U.S. Senate when he was running against Vic Raul, a man who had campaigned across the state, had hundreds of thousands of dollars in his campaign war chest, had been a 3-term state senator, a former circuit court judge, and yet Alvin Green, remember him? Alvin Green was named the winner. When Vic Raul tried to challenge that race, he found there was nothing he could do about it because South Carolina uses 100% unverifiable touchscreen voting systems. It didn't matter that there was no reason, that nobody could come up with a legitimate reason, a political reason, that Alvin Green might have won, might have defeated Vic Raul, a guy that people actually knew. So Alvin Green went on to be destroyed in the 2010 election by Senator Jim DeMint, the incumbent there, who ended up retiring early last year to head the Heritage Foundation. And that's why we now have this open house seat, because the person who was named by the Republican Governor Nikki Haley to Jim DeMint's Senate seat, Tim Scott, vacated that seat. And now we've got this race coming up in May between Colbert Bush, Stephen Colbert's sister, and Mark Sanford. And I just kind of want to get that on the map. I just kind of want to get it out there so you know the numbers right now. You know that Colbert Bush is defeating the former governor in two different polls by several points. Maybe we'll talk about that in the week ahead and see if there's anything at all that can be done about it. The problem is with the voting machines they use, there is damn near nothing. And I spoke with Vic Raul, again, the guy who lost to Alvin Green. I spoke with him earlier this week, and he told me, he said, Brad, you know what? I'm going to make sure that Elizabeth Colbert Bush knows about your story, the story you wrote on this, and I've got a good deal more details at bradblog.com. He said, I'm going to make sure she knows about it, but in truth, you know as well as I do, even if she knows about it, there's almost nothing, there's not a darn thing that can be done. That's democracy in America. Speaking of democracy in America, before we go to Desi Doyen and the Green News, she's coming up in a moment. Last fall, really, we covered the GOP voter registration fraud scandal that had broken across Florida. We were the first ones here to have the Palm Beach County Registrar on the air talking about hundreds of registration forms that had been turned in by the Republican Party, that had been collected by a Republican firm that had been created at the behest of the RNC, headed up by a guy who had several companies who had done registration before and was, over the years, going back to 2004, he'd worked with Bush Cheney, he worked with McCain Palin, he worked this year with Romney, and every time his companies would turn in fraudulent registration forms. Well, we've got a new update in that case. Colin Small, a Republican Party voter registration supervisor who secretly tossed filled out voter registration forms into a dumpster up in Virginia. He was arrested. He had been hired by Nathan Sproul's company, Strategic Allied Consulting, the one hired by the Republican Party. He had been arrested for tossing out these voter registration forms, charged with 13 counts, including 8 felonies and 5 misdemeanors. The Virginia Attorney General, Ken Cuccinelli, who's now running for governor up there, Republican, far right wing Republican, had said he would be investigating. The Commonwealth attorney assigned to the case locally has a great number of conflicts of interest. She was investigating the investigating the local Republican Party that helped her get elected. Colin Small was working for that party. And in the days just before he was arrested, Ken Cuccinelli, the state attorney general, had come by to the local GOP office there in Harrisonburg, Virginia, to give them a pep talk. And, of course, Colin Small was there. All kinds of conflicts of interest in this case. And yet it moved forward. These guys did not recuse themselves. And what do we learn on Tuesday? The 8 felony charges were dropped against Mr. Small. He still faces the 5 misdemeanor charges, but for some reason, the felony charges went away entirely. And if you look at this, one blogger, who's very excellent at Virginia politics, says this entire matter does not pass the laugh test. So I'm going to point you over to bradblog.com for more details on that so we can get to the Green News Report. But I just wanted to update you on that story. I suspect we'll have more updates in the days ahead. Courts had they worked for Acorn, they'd be in jail by now. They'd be deported by now. But no, it was the Republican firm that is actually committing voter registration fraud. So let's try not to notice, shall we? All right, let's do some green news.
It's not easy being green. It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things.
Never blending in with ordinary things. The lovely Desi Doyen joins us now. Hey, Des.
Hey, I'm actually finding it's pretty easy to be green.
Is that right?
Yeah, if you just make some personal changes here and there, it's a gradually evolving process.
Are you suggesting we need to find you a new theme song?
No, I miss Kermit too much.
Okay, all right. Well,
we all love that too much.
We do indeed. Let's get to the latest Green News Report. Then we've got a follow-up, if we have time, on the back end of this Green News Report.
So that is a pipeline that is busted and is flooded the neighborhood.
Will major tar sands pipeline spill in Arkansas doom the Keystone XL?
I need your help to communicate the gravity and the urgency of this situation.
NASA scientist James Hansen steps down to step up activism. The U.S. Supreme Court smacks down another big oil lawsuit. Plus, score one for breathers. EPA's new rules cut air pollution.
This new proposal is going to be an all pain and no gain kind of regulation.
But Republicans are against it.
Of course they are. All of that and more straight ahead. From BradBlog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
I've led the efforts in the House to support the Keystone XL pipeline.
Great. Then we'll know who to blame, Republican Congressman Lee Terry from Nebraska. This is your Green News Report. Okay, Desi, over the past 2 weeks, we have seen oil spills in Arkansas, Wisconsin, Minnesota, and not just any old oil spills, but the sticky, gooey tar sands oil that the Canadians and the Republicans and too many Democrats want to run through the Keystone XL pipeline.
I know. It's all about Canada getting the profits and America getting the pollution. But we'll get to that in a moment. First,
the science is clear. I need your help to communicate the gravity and the urgency of this situation and its solutions.
America's top climate scientist, Dr. James Hansen, has announced he is retiring from NASA this week after 46 years, and he's leaving the agency to spend more time with politics, literally. The 72-year-old Hansen says he'll focus on full-time activism and intensify his political and legal efforts to limit greenhouse gas emissions because it's that important.
And James Hansen, isn't he the one that's always quoted when people talk about the dangers of the Keystone Pipeline?
Yes, he's the one that has said that if the Canadian tar sands are fully exploited, it'll be game over for the climate.
Oh, well, nothing to worry about.
So this happened.
The smell is unbelievable. I mean, look. Incredible. And that is oil.
On Friday, a 60-year-old ExxonMobil pipeline carrying heavy tar sands oil from Canada ruptured under a housing subdivision in Mayflower, Arkansas, spilling an estimated 84,000 gallons of tar sands crude and forcing the evacuation of 22 homes and killing wildlife. Cleanup operations and state and federal investigations are underway. The Arkansas pipeline spill came just 2 days, as you mentioned, after another tar sands spill, a train derailment that spilled over 15,000 gallons of tar sands crude in Minnesota. These most recent tar sands spills have intensified criticism of the proposed Keystone XL pipeline, which, we should note, would carry 10 times the amount of heavy tar sands crude across the Midwest as that pipeline that broke in Arkansas. Glenn Hooks, executive director of Sierra Club Arkansas, explains why tar sands are even worse than regular oil on MSNBC.
This is a much bigger mess than just a simple crude spill. This is much heavier, it's much thicker, it's much dirtier, and therefore a lot more dangerous. So if it gets in the waterways, it's going to sink. It's not going to float. And so you're talking about a potentially disastrous dredging process.
That all happened over the Easter Passover holiday weekend. I guess we're going to have to find out whether politicians actually even noticed it. And what effect it's going to have now on these continuing calls to build the Keystone XL pipeline.
More pollution news. On Friday, the Obama Environmental Protection Agency proposed new rules to cut air pollution by reducing the amount of sulfur in gasoline, among other cuts that would begin in 2017. The new standards would increase the price of gasoline by a few pennies and the price of new cars by $130 in the year 2030.
Outrageous.
And would save billions in health care costs every year. But Republicans and the oil industry slammed the new draft rules, saying, say, saving lives was too expensive. Okay, they didn't really say that, but they did say that the cost would be too high for consumers and there would not be enough benefit. Tyson Slocum of Public Citizen says, and that's typical of the industry.
If you don't want to embark upon the required necessary investments in refining infrastructure, you paint a doom and gloom scenario that is in excess of what the actual costs are going to be.
They do this all the time. It's going to kill the industry. It's going to kill jobs. It's going to kill the economy. And then it never really does.
No, it never does. But score another one for anyone who breathes. The U.S. Supreme Court on Monday rejected another lawsuit brought by Big Oil's biggest lobbyist, the American Petroleum Institute, against new air pollution standards that were issued by Obama's EPA.
So this was a suit by the petroleum industry against these rules, and the Supreme Court said, nope, they stand as is?
That's right. They're going to let the lower court ruling stand, which says, yes, the EPA can do this.
For all of that and more on the oil spills all over the place over the last couple weeks as the Keystone XL pipeline pipe dream hits homes, check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. Remember, download us on iTunes, Stitcher, or TuneIn. Like us on the Facebook and follow us 24/7 on the Twitters at Green News Report. From bradblog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
Here we go. Clean up. Clean up. Girls and boys, let's clean up. Clean up.
Well done, Des.
Thanks. There's an update to that Exxon Arkansas pipeline spill story. It turns out that Exxon, because that pipeline was carrying tar sands, diluted bitumen, as it is known, or bitumen, they don't have to pay into the oil spill recovery fund. They don't have to pay that tax because diluted bitumen is not considered to be crude oil.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, and if people look, we got the video on our website. If people look at this, tell me this is not crude oil.
And this is what's supposed to be. Oh, yeah. It's supposed to be in the Keystone XL pipeline across the Ogallala Aquifer in Nebraska. That's a problem.
Unbelievable. We'll have more on that in tomorrow's Green News Report, which hopefully you'll grab at iTunes or Stitcher or TuneIn Radio or
bradblog.com.
Oh, yeah. We'll have it there, too. All right. Thank you, Desi. Great job. Thank you for producing, as usual, today. Thanks also to super-duper associate producer Margo Paez, to G on the soundboard, doing a great job as ever. Stay tuned, by the way, for the legendary 80-year-old Bob Fass. Speaking of radio unnameable, he will be joining John Wiener on the 4 o'clock report. Just seconds from now, you're not going to want to miss that. And by the way, don't forget, take a look at Shadows of Liberty if you can. Go to shadows.kcetlink.org. Also, check your local listings for Link TV nationwide and KCET here in Southern California on Friday. It's an extraordinary documentary. My thanks to Jean-Philippe Tremblay for joining us here today. Until next week, we'll see you same time, same Brad time, same Brad channel, and at bradblog.com or on the Twitters at the Brad Blog. I'm Brad Friedman on the Bradcast. Good night, America.